ever get kind of sucked into those huge corruption cases in the news? Like, how does it even get that big, you know?
Oh.
Feels like a whole other world sometimes.
It is kind of wild, right? But here's the thing. There are actually patterns to it.
Oh, really?
Yeah, it's not just totally random chaos, which is kind of cool. This PhD thesis we're diving into today,
You were
Alec,
going full academic on this one, huh?
it went deep looking at scandals in Spain and Brazil, two totally different places.
Okay, so scandals across the globe.
And get this, it turns out there are these consistent patterns in how these corruption networks like actually form.
So even with different cultures, different continents, it's like,
There's this underlying structure.
whoa, that's kind of mind-blowing. So was there one thing that really jumped out at you from all this research? Like, what surprised you the most?
Honestly, it was the size, or maybe more like the smallness of it all.
Smallness.
Yeah. We think of these huge scandals, right? Like, it's gotta be this massive conspiracy.
Right, tons of people involved.
But this research found that the average scandal, and this was in both Spain and Brazil, only involved about seven people.
Seven people.
Wow.
Seriously, that's
Yeah.
it. I figured it'd be way more to like pull off something big enough to make the news.
It is counterintuitive, isn't it?
Totally.
But it seems like smaller groups are actually behind a lot of this stuff. Makes you think maybe going after these smaller networks would be smarter than chasing this idea of some giant complex web, which might not even exist the way we picture it, you know?
No, that's a really good point. It's like too many cooks in the kitchen kind of thing.
Totally.
Maybe with corruption, smaller is actually more efficient and harder to catch.
And it gets even more interesting because the thesis goes beyond just the size of these networks.
Okay, so what else did they find?
They started looking at the actual people involved and found a pattern there too.
Oh, interesting. Like, what kind of people were they? Was there anything common about them?
So, get this, in both the Spanish and the Brazilian cases, they found the same people popping up over and over again in multiple scandals.
Wait, really?
Yeah, and not just like similar scandals in the same industry either. We're talking totally different schemes, different sectors, but the same faces kept showing up.
So it's like, you know those people who just seem to know everyone at a party, even if they're from totally different walks of life?
Exactly. The research actually calls these folks recidivist agents.
Recidivist agents, huh? Sounds kind of
It
ominous.
kind of is when you think about it. They're like the glue, the connective tissue that holds these whole corruption networks together. And they make the networks way more resilient, way harder to dismantle.
Because even if you manage to break up one corrupt group, these recidivists, they're already connected to other people. They're ready to start a whole new scheme somewhere else.
Exactly. And to figure out just how important these recidivists are, the researcher actually simulated the growth of these networks.
Wait, hold on. How do you even simulate something like that?
Yeah, it gets pretty wild. It involved a lot of complex math, computer modeling, all that. But basically, they created this system where they could create these virtual agents, right?
Yeah.
And these agents could interact, make connections based on certain rules,
So like a corruption simulator.
basically. And one of the things they could control in this simulator was the rate of recidivism.
Recidivism rate, meaning like how likely these agents were to, I don't know, to go back to their corrupt ways.
Exactly. How likely they were to get involved in another scandal after the first.
Fascinating. So what happened in this corruption simulator? What did they learn when they started messing with this recidivism rate?
Well, it turned out the higher the recidivism rate, meaning the more likely these virtual agents were to get involved in corruption again, the faster the whole network grew, and the more resistant it became to any attempts to, you know, break it up.
So it's kind of like the more people you have in a group who are constantly introducing their friends to everyone else, the faster that group is going to expand, right? Makes sense.
Right. And these recidivist agents, they're like the ultimate connectors.
Oh, so they're not just like repeat offenders. They're spreading it around too.
Exactly. They're like super spreaders of corrupt behavior.
Whoa, that's huge. So it's not enough to just go after people involved in one specific scandal.
Right.
You've got to focus on these recidivists, these super spreaders, to actually make a dent.
That's a key takeaway from all of this, for sure.
That's fascinating. And you know, you mentioned earlier that there were these really interesting visuals in the thesis. And we've been talking about networks this whole time. So I got to ask, what do these corruption networks actually look like? See, I knew this is where the math stuff would come in handy.
Right, and it's not even boring math, I promise.
No spreadsheets.
No way, this is the fun part. The researcher actually visualized these
Okay,
networks.
now that I got to see.
They're in the thesis, figures 1.2a and b. Figure a is the Spanish network, And it's wild. It's huge, this dense web, almost like a spider web, all these connections overlapping.
So it's literally like you're seeing who's connected to who.
Exactly. Makes it way more real than just talking about it, you know?
Totally. But why is the Spanish one so much bigger than the Brazilian one?
So the Spanish research, it covered a lot more scandals over a longer time period. So naturally, the network's going to be bigger and messier.
Makes sense. But yeah, the Brazilian one still has the same, like, basic patterns we talked about, right?
Exactly. Figure 1.2b, the Brazilian network, it's smaller, but you still see those clusters of recidivist agents.
Right, right. Like little hubs.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Holding the whole thing together. And that's what's crazy. These visuals prove the similarities are there, no matter how big or small the network is.
It's kind of beautiful in a weird way, you know? Like, you can pack so much info into one image. They're not just random scandals. It's all connected.
And those connections are key. If we want to understand how to actually fight corruption, seeing the data like this, it helps us see the weak points, the patterns, in a way we couldn't before.
This has been wild, honestly. We started with these massive scandals seeming impossible to grasp, and now we're seeing the patterns, the common threads, even across different countries. So what's the big takeaway here? What should we, like, carry with us from all this?
I think, first off, size isn't everything. Big scandal doesn't automatically equal huge network. Could be these smaller, tighter groups that are even more effective at being corrupt.
And we can't forget those recidivists, man. They're like the VIPs of corruption.
Right. And maybe most important, this whole thing shows us how powerful these tools are. Network science, data visualization, they can help us untangle problems that seem impossible.
Makes you think something that starts with, what, 7 people can snowball so fast, creating these whole networks of corruption that are way more resilient than you'd expect. But by understanding them, by actually seeing them, we can start to fight back more effectively. And that's what this deep dive is all about, right?
Absolutely. Knowledge is power, even when it comes to something like corruption.